Okay, so I realized that when I welcomed you, I neglected to introduce myself. So I'm Helen Elaine Lee. I'm a professor in the writing side of comparative media studies and writing, and the director of the program in women's and gender studies. And you know why? I'm a fiction writer. I write short stories and novels, and that's what I teach here at MIT also. And so I believe in the power of stories. So when we thought about what shape this event might take, I thought it was really important to give you stories, to bring you people's stories. And so we've got five powerful, beautiful, amazing women who are going to tell you their stories, and their somewhat different kind of career paths. So I'm going to introduce each person. I'll introduce a panelist, and then she'll speak, and then do the same for the others in turn. So our first panelist is Nisha McCray, and she is the founder and executive director of Bajika, which means idea in the North Angolan language of Kimbundu. Bajika is a not-for-profit organization interested in increasing relations between international innovators and leaders in different fields, especially in the Lusophone or Portuguese-speaking world, in order to develop new ideas to tackle challenges such as the consequences of population, sustainable living, education, hunger, epidemics, natural disasters, and development. The organization is focused on fostering ideas and those who create them through its educational workshops and do-it-yourself kits to equip aspiring young innovators and entrepreneurs around the world. Since its launch, Bajika has assisted over 250 students in the launch of over 35 hardware and software startups and is currently based in Boston and in Cape Town, South Africa. So, Nisha McCray.
Hi, guys. Is this on? Okay. So I just have to make sure I keep it to 8 minutes, so I'll have a little reminder just so, since I am the first person, I want to make sure I don't take up anyone else's time. But that was a great introduction, thank you. I just recently graduated from MIT, so it's still kind of awkward to be called a graduate of this place, so you have to give me a couple seconds to get adjusted to that. But I guess I should start from the beginning. So when I was younger in elementary school, we didn't really have science classes, so I didn't really know what a scientist or an engineer was until I went to middle school and I came across this book about this queen of Angola called Queen Nzinga. And she was one of the last queens of West Africa who was able to develop a kingdom despite Portuguese settlers trying to take her out, I like to say, over 60 years. And she created a kingdom in which science and technology and the best engineers would come to help her explore how could you take this knowledge and spread it across the continent. And when I read this book, I had just started my first science class in the sixth grade. And I was like, wow, like, I need to be a scientist and be like as cool as this woman. Like, this is the first woman I've met who I want to be like. And I kind of made a little promise when I finished reading the book, because it was the first book I read about someone I actually wanted to become. And on the cover, it was her as a little girl. And it was the first book I ever received that showed a black girl on the cover. And I felt like, okay, if she was able to do it and she had to fight the Portuguese every year for 60 years, I should be able to at least graduate high school. So anytime I felt a little discouraged while I was finishing my primary education, I would always reread that book and always feel like that's going to be my source of inspiration. And when I got to junior year of high school, I got this mysterious letter from MIT saying, would you like to be a part of MITES? And I was like, what on earth is MIT? And I went through my physics book and I remember seeing the word, but I didn't know what it was. And I remember seeing a picture about the atomic bomb in World War II, and it was like, yes, and a lot of the research happened on MIT campus. And I was like, oh my God, this is a university? And I don't know anything about it, and they want me to go for free? I'll take them up on the offer, but I'm pretty sure they sent this letter to the wrong person because I didn't even know the university existed, so why would I be a candidate to go? But when I got here to MIT the first time, the summer after my junior year, it was like, I'm pretty sure some of you have seen that Cinderella movie with Brandy and Whitney Houston, and Whitney Houston was the fairy godmother. It was like I was Brandy in the middle of that song, Impossible, and Whitney Houston was sprinkling fairy dust, and she's like, you could be a scientist or an engineer. You could be all these amazing things you never thought you could be. And I was like, wow, this is the school I'm going to go to. And then freshman year hit. And Whitney Houston was no longer to be found. She became the Whitney Houston of reality. I am not trying to be harsh. But freshman year, even though I went through my MITN interface, it still kicked my butt. But I was able to go through okay. And I still was like, I still want to be an awesome scientist. I still want to be an awesome engineer. I haven't figured out quite what I want to do, but I'm going to wait till sophomore year to make that decision. But then sophomore year hit. And sophomore year, there's no safety net, I like to call it, with the pass, no record, or your teachers are going to check in on you and make sure that you're doing okay. They're like, you made your decision. You decided to come back after the first taste, so you're on your own. And at that time, I also was dealing with a lot of stuff at home because my dad had terminal cancer. And during freshman year, I did have to take a leave of absence because my mom couldn't be a caretaker because she had to work. And so I was already coming back sophomore year, kind of like, oh great, I already took my leave of absence. And I felt that you only get one shot at having a leave of absence from this place. If you need to take another one because something else happens at home or something, you might as well just leave MIT. So I was really stressed out sophomore year, and I was like, I don't know if I'm going to be able to make it junior year. I don't know if this is the place. Maybe I made a horrible decision. Maybe I was too ambitious. Like, that fairy dust must have blinded me to what was reality. And then I noticed that there were flyers around in December for this course MIT was offering for the first time, and you can tell how old I am, that is for Portuguese classes over IAP. And I was like, wow. I always wanted to go to Angola, and the primary language of Angola is Portuguese. And I was like, this will be my opportunity to take language classes for free, and it'll be a good distraction from everything going on in my life. And while I was taking the class over IAP, they said, oh, you know, MIT pays for international experiences. Where would you like to go? And I was like, Angola. And they said, are you aware Angola has been in civil war for over 35 years? And I was like, yes, I am aware. I want to go. And they're like, have you ever been abroad before? I was like, no. And they're like, the State Department does not allow us to send students to areas that have been in recent conflict or there's high terrorism activity. And I was like, that's okay, that's not Angola. They go, yeah, that is Angola. So you have a choice. You can go to Portugal or you can go to Brazil. And I was like, I'm scared to go across the Atlantic. So I'm going to go to Brazil. And they said, cool beans, we'll pay for it. And I was like, why don't they tell this to everybody? That they'll just give you a paid vacation. And so I was happy and preparing to go abroad for the first time. And I was telling my mom and I was telling my dad. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to be the first person in the family to go abroad. This is going to be so exciting. Like, we made it. Like, this is the dream. And my dad was like, yeah, I'm so proud of you. Like, you're going to do great. And then during finals week of my sophomore year, they said, like, my dad only had a couple days to live. Well, you're in the middle of taking, like, two or three finals, and you get that phone call. You're kind of going, could not have come at a worse time, but I'll be okay, you know. I'll take the finals. Horrible mistake. Failed all of them because I was too stressed out. But I was like, no, it doesn't matter. Everyone's just lying to me. I'm going to go home. I'm going to be with my dad, and he's going to be around. And then I'm going to go to Brazil, and he's going to be proud of me. And then I'm going to come back to MIT, and I'm going to graduate. Did the finals, like I said, failed. Luckily, student support services were able to reverse that. But I went home, spent a couple of days with my dad. And before he passed, he told me what his childhood dream was. And he said that when he was a young boy, he was smart like me. And he wanted to be an engineer. But his teacher told him that despite his high test scores and stuff, she wouldn't write him the letter of recommendation to go to his dream school. And so I asked him what was his dream school. And he pulled out his journal from childhood, and it was the MIT dome. I did not know about MIT my entire childhood. And at that moment, I was like, whoa, that's a little deep. And he was like, it's so amazing on my deathbed that I could realize my dream of going to MIT through you. And I was like, wow. And I have a surprise for you. And I showed him my brass rat with our last name in it. And he was like, my name is in a brass rat. I'm good. And so he passed, but before he passed, I was supposed to go to Brazil the next day. And he said, don't cancel your trip because of me, because you're still making wonderful firsts for the family. And I was like, no, that's inappropriate to bury your father one day and then get on a plane and go to Brazil the next. But at the time, it was very difficult. But now looking back on it, I realized why he thought that. And so fast forward, I had a wonderful time in Brazil, came back to MIT, didn't realize while in Brazil I was using it as a distraction and probably needed to take a year off. Took the year off, but while I took the year off, I decided while I was in Brazil, I noticed what I wanted to do. And that's because while in Brazil, I realized there were a bunch of kids just like me who never knew about MIT, never knew about what they could do in science and engineering, and they were being told just like I was, oh, you should do this, because we don't want to waste time telling you what you actually can do. And that's how I got started doing Bajica, which means idea, meaning everyone around the world has brilliant ideas. They just need the opportunity to showcase them. And so while I was getting Bajica started and everything, I was just having headaches left and right about my time here at MIT, because like I said, everyone knows you get that first leave of absence and nobody calls you out on it. After the second leave of absence, everyone starts looking at you side-eyed like, okay, do you need to be here? Maybe you're at the wrong school. Maybe you're not good enough. Maybe you're not smart enough. Maybe you just need to accept that this isn't working out. And so the rest of the time that I was here, despite Bajica doing well and beside all the things I was doing, it seemed like it was very difficult every semester to prove I deserved to be here. And I never failed a class once I came back. And as I like to say, I may hold the record, and some people may actually know, I've been on 4 leave of absences from this place. So when you're talking about challenges and actually getting your degree, you can talk to me. But one of the things I feel was the greatest challenge was when I was told that despite my grades, I can no longer major in course 8. And that was because they didn't feel it was worth the time and investment, because I was on 100% financial aid, to be in course 8. And I was like, I came here to get a STEM degree. Why all of a sudden am I being told I'm not allowed to get a STEM degree? And it was in the middle of the spring term. They said, you can no longer take course 8 classes. So if you're in the middle of a spring term and you're told you no longer can take classes in your major, that's pretty much saying you need to leave campus. And that challenge I wrestled with for a good 3 days. I just stood in my room crying because I knew I was supposed to be packing, because they didn't want to tell me I had to leave, but indirectly so. But then one of my friends was talking about how she had been taking Sloan classes and there were quarter classes. And I was like, wait, I could just pretend I'm a Sloanie, because you could technically take those classes and I could still stay on campus. Huh. I ran to the registrar's office and she was like, yeah, you can take 6 Sloan classes and that could make up your course load that you're missing since you can't take course 8. And I was still at MIT the rest of the semester. I came back, they're like, oh, that was a good trick. Now you have another 2 years to complete. What are you gonna do? You have to pick a HAS major. And I was like, I'll do a HAS major, but I'll do a HAS major on my own terms. So I chose course 17, political science. And even though I love history, I love political science, I love international development, but it wasn't my passion. And I felt like I was stuck, that I was being forced to complete an MIT degree, even though it wasn't what I came to MIT to do. But then I realized, yeah, they feel they may have gotten me on that and they're trying to discourage me, but I can also take classes in course 2 and just be exploring course 2. I can also explore course 6. I can explore D-Lab. I can explore other extracurricular activities while taking political science classes. And the more I explore, the more I realize what I want to do is teach people how to take their ideas and make them reality. I probably took about 7-8 years, technically, worth of coursework in the 4 years I was here, to make sure I understood anything I needed to know about product design and development, running my business, raising funds, anything I could get my hands on. Because even though I was stuck in a major that I didn't feel was the major I had chosen for my life and career option, I still was able to make it work. And so I'll end off with this very weird roundabout story. I had notes, and apparently I took my glasses off and I can't read them now. But I would say there's three things that I want you guys to take away from this event that's really remarkable that we're actually getting together to talk about this. The first one is that you only have a responsibility to yourself. I know a lot of us came from families or backgrounds and have a lot on our shoulders, whether that's people's expectations that we are going to do X, Y, and Z and become the success of our family or community, or that our family members have made sacrifices for us to be here. But if you're not happy, no one's going to be happy about you sitting in the bathtub crying for days on end. No matter how selfish someone is, nobody wants to see someone down. The second one is you have a responsibility to your family, but not the responsibility to pay their debts, not a responsibility to make their dreams come true. My dad didn't tell me about MIT because he didn't want me to feel like I had to go to that place. The fact he was able to keep his mouth shut for 18 years before I found out that was his dream school is a testament that his responsibility was to make sure I did what I needed to do, and then his dreams came second. And I guess the final responsibility is that to your fellow sister in this room or on campus. I cannot tell you how many times I wish someone had reached out and said, Nisha, you've been gone for a year, and then you were gone 6 months, and then you were gone 2 weeks. Like, what happened to you? Like, I only remember a handful of incidences that somebody reached out to me on Facebook and said, Nisha, what's going on? And most people who may even have been close to me didn't even know what was going on. And I'll end with this really good quote by Louis C.K. You don't look into somebody else's bowl to see how much more they have than you. You look into somebody else's bowl to make sure they're eating enough. And that's the purpose of being a sister on this campus. But yeah.
Thank you, that's great. Okay, our next panelist is Javon Bickerstaff, who was course 11 and course 21W and wrote a thesis with me. She is a scholar of gender, race, family, and emotions. Her research examines Black couples in enduring relationships and the emotional care work that goes into sustaining intimacy, eschewing popular preoccupation with Black families in decline. Her current book project is a collection of nonfiction essays on Black relationships, building on her dissertation, which examines how the chronic insecurity of being Black in America shapes couples' relationships in part by fostering an emotional socialization that bolsters resilience yet undermines the vulnerability needed for intimacy. Javon teaches first-year writing at Howard University and is also the scholar in residence at the David Driskell Center for the Study of Visual Arts and Culture of African American and the African Diaspora at the University of Maryland. College Park, where she's helping the center establish a digital oral history archive of African American artists, which will become part of its permanent collection. She received her doctorate in sociology from Harvard University and MPhil, I don't know why I'm losing my voice, in psychology at the University of Cambridge, and she is a former Fulbright, NSF, and Ford Fellow.
Hey, how y'all doing? All right. So when I was asked to speak on the panel, I said yes because Helen asked me and I wasn't thinking. And then I realized that it was about careers and I was like, oh, how did I get on that panel? And so I kind of want to frame these comments as walking in the gray, or give yourself permission to everything, i.e. be human, right? And so in terms of my story was preparation for me to be here today and realize that I'm starting over once again, right? And so I did all the stuff that Helen read and I listened to it. I'm like, oh, that sounds real good, but yeah. But coming here to MIT, I came with the idea that I think a lot of students of color feel when they first get here, which is, oh my gosh, there are like smart, nerdy people too. Yes, I found my tribe. One of my tribe is down there at the end of the table. You'll hear about her brilliance later, right? But I got here, and if you come here to MIT, the reality is that you're not just a STEM person. You're well-rounded. You're a Renaissance person. You do all sorts of other things. That's how you got to be here, right? And so for me, after 801 had kicked my tail up and down the infinite a few times, I was like, huh, okay, well, I still love chemistry because that's what I came here to do. I came here to be a chemist. And chemistry is great. And then I worked at DuPont for a summer, and I was like, oh, but chemistry is not so great that I want to be in a lab for the rest of my life, right? And so my choice to go into course 11 and then having taken so many writing courses, I already had the degree, I just needed to write the thesis, I double majored. But the variations in my path that began here at MIT were very much a training ground for the starting over and starting over and starting over and starting over that would happen again and again and again. And so in thinking about kind of what my story has taught me, there are a few things that come to mind. The first thing is be as honest as you can with yourself. And then forgive yourself for not knowing now what you wish you would have known then, right? And so I think the reality is that it's very easy to say when you're thinking about your career, when you're thinking about where you're going, you need to be thinking about these elements of your life. What is it that you like? What are the things that you're talented in? What are the things that you think you might be good at? Except if you want to be Beyoncé, it is clear what you do to get to the end of your path. You sing and you dance and you practice and you hustle and you sing and you dance and you practice and you hustle and you sing and you sing and you dance and you dance and you work hard at that path. But what if you're not sure of the outcome, right? And if you're not sure of what the outcome is, then it's a lot harder to tell you what the steps are to get where you want to go. And that's okay. Right? Because most folks don't know, and most folks are making it up as they're going along because it's life school, and there's no blueprint for it, right? And so give yourself permission to not know, and forgive yourself for not knowing, because once you take that burden off your shoulder, then you can start to do the real work. The second thing I would say is, the scariest part of doing something that's unorthodox, right? And I'm a major that I have to say the words after I say the numbers when I tell folks at alumni stuff what I am. It's like, I'm course 11 and 21. 11, what's that? Urban studies and planning, right? We have like one of the flyest urban studies and planning schools in the nation, but for undergrads, it's a little less known, right? And then 21, which I don't even know that my 21 still exists in the same way that it used to, right? And so I was a social science and writing major at MIT, and folks are still like, y'all write? Like, we have the flyest Haas requirements of anywhere ever. I went to Harvard, so I can say that with knowledge, right? We take at least one every semester, no matter what you major in, right? And so in doing that, in thinking about the kind of challenges you're going to face if you do something different, right, one of the scariest parts of things is that you sometimes have to accept that you're going to have to start all over and start from scratch. And you can see that as something to be fearful of. 10 years ago, I would have been in my house crying about my life, thinking about starting all over. Now I'm like, all right, this is just part of what it takes to get to where I want to be. And so that's okay too. I think that's particularly the case if your training is not aligned with the thing that your passion is about, right? It's particularly the case when your role models are few or if you are creating a new path. And so I think people will tell you, you don't have to be beholden to your mistakes, right? We're scientists, we're at MIT, you're supposed to fail a lot. Like, that's how science happens, that's how discovery happens. And so you are lucky being here because students everywhere don't actually know that. They're afraid to fail. Failing is part of our process, and so you are already two steps ahead of most people. But also don't feel that you have to be beholden to your talents and your successes, right? If you listen to the things that Professor Lee said that I did once upon a time, I did those things once upon a time. It is all true somewhere. Those degrees exist somewhere. I don't know where all of them at, but they exist somewhere, right? And yet, my general kind of condition is not one that's really cut out for being a scholar. A scholar is about building on other people's knowledge incrementally. And I don't like to build on other people's knowledge. I don't like to be disciplined. And if you're going to be a scholar, you're going to be disciplined because you're in a discipline, right? I like to sully into things and wonder about them a bit. I'm an essayist. I'm a writer, right? Which is not the same thing necessarily as being a scholar. And so you have to allow yourself the freedom, not just from your past failures, but also from your past successes, in order to get where it is that you want to go ultimately. Finally, I think the last thing is that you have to trust the process. And that's where being a writer is really, really helpful. Because every time you sit down to write a paper, and I've now like killed whole sections of the rainforest writing things. Every time you sit down to write, you are starting from scratch. You are starting from nothing, and then at the end, there is something that exists. You create stuff. And you never really know what the thing that you're going to create is going to be. You start out thinking, I might create something that looks like X or that looks like Y, but it often doesn't look like Y. Like, it's like 1 plus 2 equals 17 squared, which don't work in no math that we know about, right? But you trust the process, because every time you've sat down to write a paper, and you've written some papers, you're here, right? You got in here somehow. Every time you sit down, nothing existed. And you finish some classes, so then it did exist. And so you trust the process, recognizing that the process is often scary. It is often unclear, but you start where you're at and you keep working at it. And so the question that you all talked about on the blue sheet that you had is, what would you do even if you know you couldn't fail? I actually think that particularly if you're an artist, if you're somebody in the humanities and the arts, perhaps the question should be instead, what would you do even if you know you would fail? Over and over and over again. Because as a writer, that's what you do, right? Sometimes you get the dialogue right, sometimes it works for a particular kind of character, and then sometimes that character has no place in that book or in that story, right? And so it's the willingness to fail. It's what would you do even if you would fail? That's where your passion lies. And getting to that is not always easy, but that's the aim. And so aim for the thing that you would keep doing even if you failed, because that's where your heart is. Thank you.
Thank you. That's great. Okay, our next panelist is Rahmat Muhammad. She is manager within Deloitte's advisory practice in the Northeast region, US. She has over 10 years of experience in the design and delivery of solutions to address complex scientific, regulatory compliance, and business operations problems. Rahmat holds a PhD in systems neuroscience from the Department of Brain and Cognitive Science at MIT. Rahmat Muhammad.
And I'll echo pretty much everything that everybody has just said and probably what everybody will say for the rest of this session. So thank you again for having me. I think this is such a great session. And I wish that, first of all, they had something like this when I was an undergrad. I actually did not go to MIT for undergrad. I came here just for the PhD. I went to Boston University for undergrad. So and at a very different time, too. So things like this didn't quite exist. So I'm going to take three pieces of what, there was a slide that Deb had up that talked about, it was the three circles, right? What you're good at, what pays well, and what you love doing. So I'm going to take each of those circles and give you my story and how I got to where I am from that. But before I even get to that, let me just start the story off by telling you guys, my parents are Nigerian. And I was born in Nigeria, so I am by definition Nigerian. If you are Nigerian or have friends that are Nigerian, your path is pretty much set, right? You're either a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. That's it. There are no other options. God forbid you come home and you say you want to be a poet. That's just, you're done. So that's it. So growing up, really, Deb was talking about that circle of what you're good at and how childhood, you know, sort of the things that you get told as a child when you're growing up. My mom really did try to be open-minded, right? When I came home and I wanted to play the guitar, she said, okay, you know, she got me the guitar. She was, I guess, wise enough at that point to know that I'll just let it play out. You know, she'll learn that she's not musical and let it go. All right, so I think she heaved a huge sigh of relief when I found that out. But over time, you know, obviously, just like you guys, I started showing that I had some interest and talent along the sciences. I love biology. And so I kept getting rewarded by my grades, by my teachers. And of course, you had the enforcement of, oh, you're going to be a doctor, all of that feeding into that, right? So growing up, that was my dream. And that was in my world, that was it. That was the adults that I was exposed to that were professionals, they were doctors. So at that point, that was my goal. Obviously, now things change as you go along, as probably some of you have already experienced. When I went to college, I got exposed to this thing called philosophy, and I just loved studying philosophers, right? So, of course, I couldn't go home and say I'm a philosophy major. That, forget it, right? So it was, I had to double major at that point. So it was a double major in biology and philosophy so that I could at least, you know, keep my parents happy while I pursued this philosophy degree. And I was also doing some work in the lab. I got exposed to research, so I knew that there was an alternative to becoming a physician, that I could do research as a scientist. And I enjoyed that a lot more than the time that I spent volunteering at hospitals. Now, which is kind of sad but true, I was like, humans, whatever, don't care. So then, you know, after the bachelor's, there was a decision point. What do you do? Do I go on and try to do this pre-med thing and force myself into this thing, you know, with my parents and trying to make them happy? They really, at that point, they didn't really pressure too much. So I said, okay, I really don't want to go into med school. Let me think about a PhD. So it was either a PhD in philosophy or a PhD in neuroscience. Now, that point, my parents were like, okay, we probably need to start speaking up a little bit here. So I chose neuroscience because it's a lot more technical and you had a few more options. And I did love it. You know, it wasn't like I was doing it for them. I really did enjoy it. I started doing that research here at MIT, had a fantastic experience. I cannot say enough. That 5.5 years was so many levels of good experience. All the people that I met, I met Deb and a lot of different people in the clubs that I was part of. The experience of just training you to think through a thesis, training you to think through how to design an experiment, how to analyze data, how to put it into a story, how to defend it. Getting to the point where you knew your stuff better than anybody else in the room, that you could stand up and actually speak to it, no matter what questions came at you, you were so confident because you spent 5.5 years, you know, digging into this thing, looking at it every single which way, right? So that, the level of confidence that gave me, I can't even put a price on that. I really can't put a price on that, because once I left and I started working, well, the decision for why I left. So at that point, right, you can go and become a postdoc, professor, et cetera. That's one path. You can also go into industry and start working for a pharma company doing research there. That was another path. And then you had consulting, which was a third path that people were taking at that time. In my mind, I wanted to make money. Like, to be quite honest, it came down to, look, at some point, I'd like to get paid. And you know, and I really did not love the research so much that I could see myself doing it much longer. I had fun, but the fun ended. And then I thought, okay, well, this fun has ended. It's time to move on to something else. So Luckily enough, you know, MIT had a lot of different career service offerings. We had a huge career day where, you know, lots of booths, everybody was setting up a booth. I literally had a stack of resumes and I was just throwing them at everyone. I had no plan, just throwing them at whoever would take. No plan whatsoever. All I knew was I needed to get a job. So one company finally called me, and they were a technical and scientific consulting company. They're called Exponent, highly recommended if anybody wants to look into the consulting path. They're different from management consulting, which is what I'm doing right now. Deloitte, McKinsey, BCG, et cetera, they're more management consulting. Exponent was more scientific and technical, and it was a great transition for me as a PhD because it allowed me to kind of have one leg in the academic sort of atmosphere while I had another leg in the sort of real world, business world, right? Whereas if I got thrown into McKinsey and such, I probably would have had a more difficult time adjusting as a PhD. As a bachelor's, you might be okay, but PhD, it would have been more difficult for me. Anyway, Exponent, wonderful experience. I can tell you a lot more about that if anybody's interested. It was great. It paid well, allowed me to buy a house, an investment property actually. I live in one unit, rent out the others, one's a commercial unit, so I got my like financial situation under control. I felt good. And I thought, okay, after about 3.5 years, great colleagues, nothing bad to say about Exponent, but I thought, no, I'm bored. Like literally, I said, okay, I'm bored, next chapter. I wanted to explore a little bit more about the business world, because again, Exponent was more science and engineering based, more about the business world. And so I had friends at Deloitte and I started reaching out to them and, you know, talking to them about it. And they said, you know, we think you might be a good fit. All right. So then I managed to get into Deloitte, have been there for about 3.5 years as well. There, exposure to a much bigger world, right? So more about business, more about business process. And again, something that I wanted to learn about. So that's where I am now. And I'm now looking at what my next step is gonna be. I know what my end goal is. I'm still trying to figure out how to get there. And it's probably gonna take another couple of hops to get there. But I love the path, I love the journey, and I mean, even when I get there, odds are I might find out that, hey, maybe it's not really where I wanna be. And you have to get used to just being okay making a decision to change, and change is fine. Look, you guys are not gonna screw up anything at this point. The only way that you're gonna screw up is if you go on drugs or something. Seriously, at this point, no decision you make is ever going to be the wrong one. You're gonna be fine. So just be okay making a decision at the moment, exploring it for the time that it makes you happy. When you're no longer happy, figure out another way. And I mean, there's really no other trick to this. It's really as simple as that.
Thank you. Ama Edo is currently, well, actually, she didn't have this on her bio, but she went to MIT for undergraduate school, where I believe she and Devon were part of the same tribe. So she's currently finishing her PhD in the program in history, anthropology, and science, technology, and society here at MIT. Her dissertation is an anthropological study of how Africa is produced along the path of Dutch wax cloth, also known as African print cloth, between the cloth design in the Netherlands and its use in Togo, West Africa. Over the years, Ama has considered many career paths: medicine, mechanical engineering, actuarial science, conflict resolution, public health practice, psychotherapy, dot, dot, dot. For now, she has settled on anthropology and teaching. And for now, she'll be staying on at MIT for the next 2 years as a postdoctoral research associate in the Global Studies and Languages program, where she'll be teaching classes on African studies and cultural production. So some of you take her classes. Ama.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm really happy to be here. This is a really, really great event. And I'm, you know, excited to be on the panel, but also to learn from everybody else's experiences, because as everybody's alluded to, this is an ongoing process. And I'm really grateful for how everyone's emphasized that, even for them now. It's not that for us now, it's not that we have arrived and we figured out our lives, like far from there, but rather that these are questions that we kind of perennially keep coming up keep coming up against. And I really want to emphasize that point, because the kind of thing I would do if I were in the audience at a talk like this is go home and feel bad about myself, because I feel like, oh my God, everybody's figured it out and I still don't know what I'm doing. So just, I don't want you to go home and feel that way, because I absolutely do not know what I'm doing still. So to pick up on points that have been made earlier, when I look back on my trajectory, I see that a lot of the shifts that I made along the way happened around moments of what felt like failure, right? All those things that Helen read out, I actually did consider at some point or another. And like you, I came to college thinking I was going to be a doctor. I wanted to save the world. I was gonna go be with Doctor Without Borders, and it was clear, you know, I'd been good at science and math, and I came here. And then took a first bio class, realized, oh, I actually don't like it that much, and two, I'm not that good at it. Okay, so then, you know, my friends, most of them were declaring course two, mechanical engineering, and I was like, well, that seems like a good thing to study at MIT, so I declared that. And then I went on an internship like Jovan and realized, nope, this is not what I want to do for the rest of my life. Came back sophomore year. At this point, I've gone through two majors already, right? So sophomore year, I decided, okay, I don't want to do engineering, but I'm at MIT. I should do something MIT-like. So then I decided, well, I like math. Let's keep going in math. Okay, I declare that. I mean, it just kind of went on that way, right? And each time, I changed four times. I changed, and I ended up in political science also. But each time I changed, if I'm honest, I would have probably stayed on any one of those tracks if I'd actually been good at them. You know, if I'd done well in them, I probably would have stayed because of the idea of success that was sold to us at the time, right? Actuarial science, I remember, came up because this TA from Interphase or somewhere was saying, oh yeah, you make good money as an actuary. I didn't even know what an actuary was. I just knew that you'd make $80,000 after college if you did that. So I was like, okay, I can do that with a math major? Awesome. I'm gonna be, you know? It was that kind of reasoning that I was following when I was in college. So I think I would have been in a lot of trouble if I actually had been good at any of those things that I pursued. But luckily for me, it felt like I didn't have a choice. I couldn't keep doing the things I was doing because I was just so miserable doing them. And so each time that guided me to the next thing. And so I say that these things felt like failure because on one hand, like everybody else here, I want to acknowledge the fact that failure is absolutely normal and something that happens and something that's necessary. So, you know, to sort of destigmatize the idea of failure. But at the same time, to say that what looks like failure in one frame, in a different frame, is just the beginning of something that's new and better, right? So it's both failure is okay, but failure is not necessarily failure at the same time, if that makes sense. So I think, you know, I think, okay, so I'm there, I'm in a situation, and I'm failing. Okay, how do I get to the next thing, right? So it was, again, something that came up in a few of your stories was kind of keeping my eyes open and picking up on little things that were around me on the flyers at MIT. I did a lot through the, like, just following funding, like, flyers about funding that was coming up, opportunities. But I was thinking about, essentially, I would break it down into two categories of, I don't want to call it advice, but something like that, right? So I think there's a set of sort of concrete, immediately actionable kinds of things that I think I done and I keep doing when I encounter these moments of failure and uncertainty. And I think there's some sort of long-term foundational big picture kind of things. So in terms of the concrete things, this came up during the presentation also, was not trying to do it by myself, right? So talking to people, talking to friends, talking to professors, talking to people. I mean, I remember this time when finally, you know, I was a political science major, and then I started drumming because there was drumming that was happening on campus. It was a Senegalese drumming troupe that had started, and I really loved it. So I got money, and I went to Senegal for a summer to go work on that. Then I said I was going to stay there for 6 months and study drumming for 6 months and take a semester off from MIT, and then I ended up coming up earlier. And I literally did not know where I was going to live, how I was going to pay for my food or anything like that for the rest of the semester because I didn't have a plan. I came back earlier. And I was on the steps at 77 Mass Ave talking to a friend that I had met through a study abroad program that I had done also in my escapes from MIT. And I told them, I have no idea what I'm doing, next week. Like, I don't know where I'm living. And he said, oh, come up to our office. We're looking to hire a research assistant. And she wanted a grad student, but maybe she'd be open to talking to you. I went up and met this woman who became a really important mentor, and that opened up the whole next chapter of going to Zambia, of becoming a Fulbrighter, of going to my master's. You know, it was just talking to people about where you're at. So not trying to do it on your own. And then also just trying stuff. I think trying stuff, and sometimes it takes, sometimes it doesn't. So after I went to Zambia for 3 years, I came back and did a master's at Harvard in public health, because that was the work that I'd been doing in Zambia in international health. And I was supposed to go on that path, but then I was looking at jobs and I felt like, this stuff bores me. Like, it's not interesting to me. So then I was working at the school doing some curriculum development, and someone said, oh, there's a professor, a new black woman at MIT in Enthro, who's doing work in Haiti. I speak French. I thought maybe she needs some translation work, something. I have time. So I came, and she took me out to lunch, and she's like, we have a PhD program. Apply. And I thought, well, I wasn't planning on going. But she's like, and I had time. I had nothing else to do. I was bored at my job. So I actually had time to apply, and I applied. And I applied for a Ford Fellowship. And I got the fellowship, and I got into grad school. And I was like, well, guess I'm going back to MIT. But each time, I was also considering other avenues at the time. I was like, okay, I'm going to try this. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, I'll reconsider, right? So trying stuff out. I'll save you the anecdotes. But then another thing is that I know I've been in this place a lot at MIT. If you're at the point where you hate everything in life, you hate everything at MIT, you hate all your classes, you hate it all. Try to find, if there's one thing that you enjoy, right? If it's like a language thing, if it's reading, if it's going to coffee shops, if it's a dance class, if it's anything that you derive any amount of pleasure from, find that thing and do it. For me, when I was here, I took German classes for my first 2 years every semester. My parents were like, why are you taking German? It's like the most useless language. Like, why? Take Spanish, take something useful. But I had taken German in high school, and it made me happy. And everything else sucked. I was bad at everything. I was getting bad grades. I could go to German and feel and just enjoy myself. And I think it's really important to connect with that feeling of pleasure and joy and satisfaction, because I feel like the more you connect with that, the more you're able to recognize it when it does happen. And that can help you open up to other opportunities. But it also opens up possibilities to meet people, mentors, other friends, build community. Again, that's how I found mentors who have been with me since for the many years since then. And leaving MIT is the other thing that I think is critical. Whether that's a leave of absence, whether it's about taking MIT money to go on a summer trip, even if it's just leaving MIT and being in Cambridge outside of MIT, but just leaving this place, because we get caught up in a very particular way of seeing the world and seeing life. And once you leave MIT, you realize it's possible to work hard and sleep. It's possible to work hard and have a social life. It's possible to have fun. There are things that you forget. I know I forgot them. Maybe you guys are like really well-balanced human beings, but I forgot them until I left and I remembered, and then helped me shape the life that I wanted to live. So those are kind of like concrete things, the sort of foundational long-term things. I think the most important thing I would say is that we all need to cultivate what it is that we need to withstand moments of uncertainty and difficulty, right? We need to do whatever it is we need to do to be okay with difficult periods, because they are gonna come, right? Like, they happen all the time. And so it's always useful to sort of have that foundation. Now, whatever that might be for you, spirituality, whatever shape it comes into, therapy, I am a huge proponent of therapy. I think it's incredibly important. Just as a way of getting in touch with you, getting to know yourself and your emotional world, recognizing, knowing what it feels like for you to be sad or angry or anxious, knowing it in your body so that you can notice it when it's coming up in situations, so that you can be attuned to your intuition. There are these things that we have built into us that we need to kind of learn to access and to have. When we need it most, which is in these times of difficulty. So really cultivating that in an ongoing way. And part of that is also relationships, like your friendships. All these little anecdotes that I've mentioned, like my friends have been were often, if not always, the catalyst saying, hey, you kind of like that anthropology stuff. Why not take a class in that? I was like, oh yeah, I'd forgotten that, could, you know? So friends, spirituality, therapy, I think these things are incredibly important, and I am happy to talk to anybody about therapy and the many benefits of it. But really cultivating what it is that you're gonna need in order to sustain yourself when the hard times come is really critical, I think.
Live panelist is Dr. Robin Chapman, and I'm so grateful to Robin for generously stepping forward to be on the panel when Kalia couldn't be here. She is the Associate Provost and Academic Director of Diversity and Inclusion and lecturer in the Education Department at Wellesley College. She provides strategic leadership and vision for the college's diversity and inclusion efforts, academic and faculty excellence initiatives, and external institutional partnerships. She earned her SM degree at MIT's Artificial Intelligence Lab and her PhD in Electrical Engineering and Computer Science from MIT. Her research and teaching interests include design and the use of computational tools for learning in public spaces and examining equity issues as they relate to learning technologies and culturally responsive pedagogy. She published the chapter, Diversity and Inclusion in the Learning Enterprise, Implications for Learning Technologies, in the 2016 Wiley Handbook of Learning Technology. Robin Chapman.
Okay, so hi, everyone. Hi, still awake, great. Yeah, I've been really enjoying just watching you all. You know, I don't actually get a chance to be in a room like this very often with just amazing black women just all here. So if you haven't had an opportunity to take some time and like do it, you should just like just take that in. You should just really look around the room and appreciate that, because when you're running around with classes and labs and whatever it is that you're doing, you probably don't get a chance to just absorb that. So right now I'm just enjoying it. So thank you for having me. One of the things, first of all, these are all, everything I hear, I feel like you're going, yeah, girl, you know about that. Woo! But, I didn't want to, get on the mic. So, but there's a couple of things I want to point out, especially particularly about being at MIT, the MIT experience, is that when I was at MIT, and I'll go on, I'll mention a few details about different things, but the whole idea of what I feel when I left MIT and, had that 6-month recovery period, that I realize I appreciate almost the most that I got from being at MIT, and I use it every day, is that the MIT thing that you get is you learn how to set or ask good questions. And that sounds like a really trivial thing. Like, you learn how to solve problems, too. You learn how to the equations and stuff, but they do that in other places. That's not as important. But and I hear this all the time. I work directly with the provost and the president. I'm on the cabinet. I work with the trustees. So I'm working. I work with presidents at other colleges. So I'm doing stuff at this level. And whenever I'm in any conversation, especially when we're thinking about strategically, where is this institution going to be in 20 years or 50 years? What do we need to do today for 50 years from now? There's a lot of information, and I'll just start talking about, if you design, you think this way, and they're just like, wow. Like, that's the first thing they say, is like, wow. And they go, the questions that you think of that we need to think about so that we can figure this out, like, we would have never even thought of taking all that data and just, like, being able to think of the right question to ask. So you should appreciate that about, and it may not feel like that's what you're doing and that's what you're learning here, but I can guarantee you when you leave here, it's gonna be really obvious to everyone that you encounter and that you work with. So you don't have to believe me, because somebody told me that when I was a student here and I didn't believe it either. But then once I went out into the world, you've seen it, right? People are just like, wow, the way you frame, the way you, I love watching that. So they keep doing that. I really like the idea that we talk so much about the importance of failure. And actually, I don't think a failure is a bad word at all. I mean, I am an engineer, but so to me, it's actually kind of exciting because, you know, something didn't quite go the way you expected. It's an opportunity to redesign, to optimize, to throw it out and start from scratch and think outside the box. I mean, that's what it is. And even if your area is not a STEM area, that's what you need to do to succeed. And I don't know anyone, I don't remember who said it, that I know that I look at and go, wow, that person's really got it together. And I used to think they came out fully baked, just together, you know, looking great. But no matter who I see now, when I see even Michelle Obama, it doesn't matter who I see, I already know they have fallen down so many times that it's just they've lost count. And they've gone in directions that they've never even imagined they've been in. People often ask me, what will you be doing in 5 years? Right? And I say, well, I know I'm going to be doing something really interesting, but I really don't know what that's going to be. Now, I know what I think I might want to be doing in 5 years, but 5 years from now, I could be doing absolutely anything, and that's very exciting. And that's a way to think about, even as you're thinking about your career, you know, in anything that you're doing, and you talked about it as well, I mean, you definitely talked about it, at any time that you just, you know, these are forks in the road. Those are opportunities. It's not failure when you have to all of a sudden think, I have to go in a different direction. It's opportunity. So think of that as being really exciting. One of the things that I really think a lot about is this term cultural capital, or the sort of the things that based in your culture and upbringing and your way of being with the people whose relationships are important to you, how you bring that into this space called MIT. And people often think, you know, we come here and, you know, we have to in some way sort of become like something else, or a certain model or someone else in order to be successful. And so throw all of that out, because somebody made that up. You talked about that's totally made up, just so you know. Be true to yourself, be who you are, and all of the things, for me, just to give you an example, the kind of cultural capital I bring, you know, I'll talk about my grandmother who recently passed, 14 days shy of being 102. And so this is a woman that grew up, was a sharecropper. I mean, you don't even want to think about what this woman went through. The whole nine yards, never finished high school, put her kids through high school, moved to New York. Then she went back to high school. And then they finally had the civil rights movement in the 60s, and she was able to stop cleaning people's floors and houses, and was able to get a job in the post office because they had to hire people then. Before that, she could never get those jobs. And, you know, went on and did, and she did a bunch of other things that I won't even list because she had, you know, 101 years to do them. But, you know, the fact of the matter is I learned from her that, you know, there are many paths and there are many times that you will even almost psych yourself out and feel like you can't continue, but it's all in your head. And so what she used to say, because I called her a lot while I was in MIT, I was like, Grandma, I don't think I'll be able to stay here anymore. I mean, 5 times people had to actually talk me out of leaving. And I'm glad they did it, not because I decided I wanted to leave because my passion was elsewhere, but because my passion was here and what I was doing, but I was just wanted to leave because I felt like there were too many obstacles, or it was just too, I just didn't know where to turn. And so, of course, I called my grandmother every time. And, you know, one of the things she basically said was, let me give you a reality check. She said, the reality check is you have brought things into that, you know, blankety blank blank place that they wish they had the capacity to be able to do and to bring into your area. In my case, it was artificial intelligence and computer science. She said, you know, they wish you had that. She said, just remember how you got to MIT. And I ended up writing a poem, and I don't write well. I mean, it was like poetry, but I actually have the poem in this thing that I wrote. I'm very proud of that, about MIT. And, you know, my grandmother inspired it. You know, I wrote about the, you know, elevator operators and, you know, the rape victims and this whole string of people in my family so that I could be here at MIT today. Now, that doesn't mean, oh, I have to stay at MIT because these people are sacrificed. It means everything in them my cultural capital is already in me. And so all I have to do is decide what it is I want and what is going to make me happy and what I'm passionate about and what if I did fail, I would keep on doing. And so just keep reminding, that's the reality, actually. So just keep reminding yourself of that reality. That's really important. The other thing I actually do for myself, and I advise my faculty and my proteges and other people to do when they get a chance, is to chart your leadership growth journey. And so some of you may have seen that kind of thing before, and usually you just do it by drawing pictures or whatever form you want. If you look it up, Google it, there's like a million options for how to do that. But essentially, these are the points in your life where you went in one direction or another, and then look at what influenced, whether it was a direction that ended up being a minus, like it could have been an event that was a minus, like for me, the death of my grandmother, but it caused a fork in the road for me where I made a decision. And if you really like map that out, what happens is, first of all, you need to look at it every once in a while, especially when you're thinking, oh, I can't. Just look at that so you can get a reality check about how amazing and resilient that you are. But you will actually begin to see the pattern of how you do the successful you, how you do the are true to yourself and how you move forward. So I guess the last couple of things I'll say is that with the resilience in particular, another thing you should do, I know this is going to be hard. Someone told me this when I was a grad student, and I laughed at them, but it turns out they were right. And so schedule time. This is already hard, right? So schedule time, sometime, I don't know what it is, put it in your calendar. That's your time. And I used to make it a different color, like you can color it a different time blocks. And that time is sacred time. So you can never delete it. If there was a way to make it so you couldn't delete it, you can't delete it. You can move it maybe within close by, but you cannot delete it. This way you make sure you have that time for you to do whatever you want. You know, drumming. I did that drumming thing too over in building in 14. You know, the drumming, you know, we did belly dancing, you know, to do whatever that thing is you need to do to, in a way, it's not getting out of yourself, it's getting more into yourself. And then sort of getting centered and just, you know, have people around you that can give you the reality check when you need it. For me, when I was here, there were, well, everybody here, Aida and other people. But then also, you know, the Black Graduate Student Association, because I was a graduate student, is BSU as well. ACME, which we actually started when I was a graduate student. Woo-hoo! The Academy of Courageous Minority Engineers. So it's been around a while. We don't put a lot of people through there. And, you know, I actually was a GRT in Newhouse and Simmons when I was here. And I have to tell you, that helped me stay grounded because my students, you know, I had good relationships with my students, and they helped me. They took care of me, and I took care of them. So it was, you know, whatever your circumstance is, just give yourself that reality check because, you know, this is the kind of place where everything's happening so fast. And depending on where you land, like which department or program, your experience will be very different from someone else's. So, you know, you keep hearing, it's the noise someone mentioned. You hear this, like, noise, signal noise. It might have been Michelle Obama actually said that. You know, but the fact is you need to, yeah, it's Michelle, yeah. Yeah, you need to have that reality check about what you bring and who you really are. Because I have to tell you, in the role I have now in particular, I have to do a lot of travel and stuff like that. And so I end up, you know, going to these places. I'm always the only Black person, pretty much. I mean, yeah, pretty much. You know, and I'm in the room with people who think, you know, they're really hot stuff and they're doing whatever. But, you know, so are you and so am I. And, you know, it's really important that you know who you are and know your value and know your worth. You don't have to prove it to anybody because you don't need to. You know, you just move through as yourself and you just stay true to yourself. And I know you probably heard that and it sounds almost like a cliche, but the fact of the matter is at the end of the day, whatever your core values are, whatever the thing is that's important to you, that's what's important. There is nothing going on at MIT that's more important than you being true to yourself. They're not doing anything on this campus. I don't care what they try to make it sound like, more important than that. And so and if you forget, just get someone to remind you, those relationships. And my last shameless plug is, yes, I'm a Ford Fellow, once a Fellow, always a Fellow. I'm also the regional liaison for the Ford Fellows Fellowship Program. And so if you are an undergrad or grad student, I think you're gonna be needing some money, you need to come see me. And if you're someone who's interested in scholar development, how to strategically develop yourself, I do that with faculty mostly, but I did it with students when I was here, then I'm happy to talk to you about that as well. And so I'll end it on that note.
And are there a few questions?
Hi. So for those of you who completed...
Use the microphone during the tape. Can you walk up to the microphone?
Hi. So for those of you who completed graduate degrees, even though some of you have changed paths since, like you doing public health or so, what do you think about those degrees and sort of the lessons you learned, or would you have done it differently given your current goals?
Okay, so I'll start with that. So in my case and in others, it's a PhD, but even if it's your master's. I'm a computer scientist by training. And so my area of interest was self-organizing systems, and there were some other pieces of computer science. Turns out, I loved programming for like 12 years, and all of a sudden I didn't want to program anymore, so that was a problem. But it turns out the way you process information, the way you go about in your sort of formal methods of inquiry that are related to computer science as a discipline, I still use in the work that I do. I mean, the work that I do with whole groups of people, they're self-organizing systems, and I have to figure out how to populate those systems and do other things so that they converge on the kind of behavior that I want. That's essentially what I do, but it's harder with people. I think the whole point, especially with a PhD, but with a master's as well, you know, the whole point of having a PhD is so you can do whatever you want. You do not have to do anything at all related to the area, and it's important if you want to continue in it, but it's important if you don't want to continue in it, because you learn things about how to go about starting from scratch with something you never heard of the day before, and within a reasonable period, a couple of months or so, becoming almost an expert enough to contribute to the field. So you can actually do anything you want. So that's actually what you're getting here while you're at MIT, the ability to do that.
I would echo that 100%. I feel so confident just literally walking out of Deloitte tomorrow. I can do whatever at that point, right? It's the ability to ask the right questions, which I cannot stress enough. When you walk out of here, you don't realize how unique that ability is. And when you walk out of here and you start to interact with normal people, whatever that means, you'll see that it's a very unique unique ability, and I promise you no amount of money could replace that. And being able to, again, look at information in a structured way, in a systematic way, again, you think because everybody, you know, to the left and to the right of you can do it, once you get out into the real world, forget about it. You're probably going to be the only one in a room at any given time that can do that, so.
I would say I like the fact that I have a PhD. That's kind of sexy. If you would have talked to me this time last year, which somebody down the road can attest, I wasn't sure that was going to be a PhD. I think in the humanities and social sciences, it's slightly different, right? I feel like the kind of analytical black box skills that you get as a scientist, like I feel like people come to MIT, and MIT is great because it teaches you to ask like stupid, crazy questions that everybody can't ask. It's like how to build a boat 101 all year long, and then at the end it's like, build me a house, and you know how to build a house because that's MIT. But in the humanities and social sciences, you can get really so particular in what it is that you do, it is harder to see sometimes that your skills are transferable. So I think that that's a challenge. That doesn't mean that it's not worthwhile. Like, I questioned myself in doing the PhD, not because it was not a worthwhile experience. I still don't think I've learned as much anywhere, and I've gone to school lots of places, as I learned here as an undergrad. But I do think that in the humanities and social sciences, it's a slightly different challenge. I think that you can still parlay that PhD into doing some really, really cool stuff. I'm a person who I don't like to build on other people's knowledge. So if you are a PhD, that becomes challenging. Right, but they also let me, like, I have a PhD study in Black love. Like, I can't really argue about that too hard and feel bad.
So we will do a couple more questions, but I wanted to pause for a minute. One of the things we would like to do with My Sister's Keeper is pull in the Black women alumni who live in the area and get them, you know, involved and as part of our circle. And so Christella Jones Prather sent out an email to the BAMIT folks and told them about this event, and we have an alum who came today, and so she wants to introduce herself in the interest of community and networking and all that.
Okay. Hi, I actually have a loud voice. Hi, my name is Patricia Tellis Warren. I'm in the MIT class of 74. With my degree in 75, so everybody in here is younger than me, which is a problem, of course. Much of what you may be, it may be you and me only, sister. But much of what all of you said, I don't know, bothered me because it's like the same story that I had to say it in 1970 when I got here, and here you are, and we're in 2016, and you all look younger than my daughter, and you're telling the same story. Like, coming at MIT, and I didn't know anything about MIT, and I didn't want to come because they didn't have a football team, and I'm from Alabama, and my mother wanted to be the Tuskegee, and this guy comes and said, MIT, he says they have 6 women and no football team, and they don't have homecoming. I'm like, what kind of college is that? I've been dreaming of college. And so my guidance counselor said, you're going to MIT, they're offering you 2 years full scholarship, a fifth year full scholarship, and the other year is loan and scholarship. You're going to go. I don't care. It's like, okay. Just go for 2 years. Okay, go. So I come to MIT, and I spent 5 years walking around saying to the assistant dean who saved my life, a couple of them, I say, they made a mistake. MIT don't make mistakes. Nope, they made a mistake. I'm not supposed to be here. I know I'm not supposed to be here. I wasn't flunking courses. I just wasn't a techie. I wasn't an engineer. I wasn't, I started off as a math major. Ugh, don't like math. What am I going to do with that? And I ended, then I kind of went back and forth and I took law-related courses. By the way, I'm a lawyer. I took law-related courses, which I could do in urban studies and political science. So I started doing that. I ended up with an urban studies major. But I still didn't know what I wanted to do. And, you know, it's like my senior year, I'm sitting there, I'm like, oh my God, I've stayed as long as I can. I got to go work. Oh my God, work. And my friend Eric says, I'm going to apply to law school. Says, I used to want to do that. Yes, law schools, that sounds really good. So I applied to law schools. Eric applied to management schools. The next time I saw Eric, he was on TV on the Oprah show. So I have nothing to say to him since. He never went to law school. And I left here and went back to the University of Alabama Law School. And then I came up here after law school. And I started working in legal services. And for the last 37, 38 years, I've worked in legal services and social services, Department of Social Services as a lawyer. So I do custody cases, divorces, and all of that stuff that after 37 years, I cannot tolerate one more second. So I've been out for the last 4 months. I had double knee replacement. And I am deciding now that I need to do something else with the rest of my life. And so that's why I found it very interesting when you were talking about changing careers, because I grew up in the 60s. We came to MIT in 1970. We were protesting the war. Huey Newton and Angela Davis on my wall. We're walking around with masks. We're protesting about the president's office. I called him an asshole. He actually remembered that 40 years later. I was so shocked. And you know, we're protesting everything. So that's the spirit, you know, from Montgomery. I grew up in, and that's the spirit we came to MIT. So we were the second largest class We had 6 black women in our class, and we had 6 in the one before, so we had like, no, 7 in ours and 6 in this. 13 black women all together. So, oh my God, it was a panic. But so I wanted to go, I always wanted to do law because I thought that was like a way to help people. The guidance counselor is the one that made me come here to MIT. And I did law, and then I came back, and I've been working in legal services, and I always wanted to help black people. That's what I thought we were going to do, because we were all going to be saved. I was marching around in the 60s. And I don't know if I'm satisfied with that's what I've done in the past 37 years. And now with more Black Lives Matter and voting rights, all the stuff that's going on, I'm like, okay, so I need to go back to Montgomery, walk along, try to get people to vote once again, put a grocery store in the neighborhood, which is depressing to me, but it needs to be done. And that's where I'm trying to figure out what I'm gonna do next. And my daughter is like 27 in Mississippi, so I'm learning Mississippi law because she's about to get kicked out at midnight because she's teaching Black Panther codes to the Mississippi students for a history class. But you all are just wonderful. When you leave MIT, you will be amazed. People go, oh, you went to MIT. Oh, that's a big brass rat, which I don't have. I left on my dresser, but I have the miniature one. I'm like, that's not a big one. So, but you will be amazed. You will say MIT, and people will go, oh my God, how did you get there? I said, well, I flew up the first time. I've taken a couple of buses. But you all are really wonderful, and you're working really hard. I'm around here. I live in Roxbury. Have a house there. My daughter is in Mississippi, so I'm just sitting there trying to figure out my next life. So I'll leave my name and phone number. I work at North Station in Greater Boston Legal Services. So if you you want to panic and you want to cry and you want to tell somebody, you know, Shirley Jackson used to be my tutor for physics, so I got stories about her. And so I mean, you know, I can talk about things. I've been married. I've been divorced. And married to the guy who I tried to pretend I wasn't smart around, and it just doesn't work because when you're smart, and it's very hard to say you're not. So anyway, that's all I want to say. I'll leave my name with Helen, and I think all of you are wonderful, and I've enjoyed all your stories.
So let me ask, I know Aiden wants to say something, but are there any students who have questions first? There's
So, first of all, this is a great, we got this on film, right? I think it's very good because it's important to recognize that we're not fragmented. And it's so easy to interpret what you've heard tonight as some kind of broken story, and it's not a broken story. This school has gotten along on its kudos for a long time. And I am a counseling person. I work in student support services almost 30 years now. And I can tell you that until I walked through these doors, I didn't find people that I could really counsel except for you. And the reason is that I've always been a fragmented person myself. I look at things and I see you as you are. And there are several of you sitting up here that know me. And what I've done over the years is completely break all the rules of counseling. I'm not supposed to, I'm in my office laughing with the people. We go down the street and we plan a thing and then we have whatever it is. Because that's who you are. And that's who you have to be. With one caveat, you have got to become leaders and to build those things that you think are important. And you can work for other people, that's fine. Go ahead and work for them for a while. Pick up their skills. But do something. Be an Ida B. Wells Barnett. Be someone who does things your way for our people. Because if you don't do that, nothing else will work, okay? And I've done that. I've worked with children who are in trouble. I've worked in AIDS programs. I was the head of the Black Community AIDS program. I've done all these things. And I came here to work with you because I knew that you would move forward. And you're doing like this. I want you to do it. Kick you down the road a little bit. And I can tell you that you will make me most happy when I hear that you have done the thing that is most important to you for yourself and for your people. And you guys know me. I'm the advisor for the Black Women's Alliance. I've tried to resign at one point. Nobody accepted that at all. That's it. you don't accept it, but there are other people. They said, no, we want you. I didn't ever understand. I'm trying to say this in a way that is loving and caring. You got the career services person. You have Helen, one of my dear friends. I just turned 70 on Friday, so I am telling you, I'm telling you that this will make me most happy in my life to see you all. Okay, now time is over. We don't have to be upset about something. We can be in therapy. We can do whatever we want. We can have all of this stuff, but please do it. And each of you has a heart that is yours. This school has no idea who it produces. Across this campus, there are people who outlive this school. And actually, that's the rule. That's the role of a school. MIT just can't admit it. It thinks it owns everything. So you have someone like Helen who's been teaching here how long? 20 years, running and screaming to teach. And you know, you have been. You say, well, I don't know. Do I need to be? I say, yeah, you need to be here. There are some of us that need to be here. And her tenure and the tenure of the other black women who came here. When I came here in 1989, nobody was tenured. One person was dead. That was it, over in the Sloan School. They brought a group of people, and now for the first time, we have leadership of tenured black women on several areas on this campus. And that's also true of Latinas. And that's going to be true of Asian women as they move up. And we need to do us on this campus because nobody else can do it. Okay, so I just thought I'd say that. I love all of you.
All right, so thanks again. Another round of applause for the panel. And I also want to thank my program manager in Women's and Gender Studies, Emily Neal, who always pulls everything together so beautifully, and Deborah Liverman and Tyrene Jones, and Aida and Latari. Sisters, keeper, comrades, and all of you for coming. Thanks so much.